watching America Trends. I'm Mary Burt-Godwin, and we are segueing from social media, all things social media, to the world of the San Diego Zoo. I'm a native San Diegan. I grew up here. I grew up going to the San Diego Zoo, the world famous San Diego Zoo, and I love it. And I'm so excited to welcome our first guest, Rick Schwartz, AKA Zookeeper Rick. And he's going to be here to talk about all the animals and everything that they had to withstand during the pandemic. So, Rick, thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, thanks for having me. I really appreciate
it. Are you zooming in from the safari park?
You would think, yes. This photo behind me here is actually one that I took at the safari park. So I was just, you know, thumbing through my phone like, wow, that actually turned out really nice. And so now I use it as my background.
It's perfect. It's perfect. Yeah. I love it. So first, before we get into all the everything about the pandemic and how it affected the animals, I want to talk a little bit about you. I've been hearing the name Zookeeper Rick for years, and you are a bit of a beloved icon in the city, I would say. So tell us a little bit about your journey and how you got started with the San Diego Zoo and how you got this title and doing what you're doing.
Well, thank you. I'm flattered to have bestowed upon me some sort of iconic ship in San Diego. I think it's only because of where I work, though, not because of anything else. You know, the San Diego Zoo is the zoo of zoos. And my entire life growing up, I just loved being around animals. In about middle school, I found out you can actually have a career working with animals. They'll pay you to spend time with animals and clean and feed them. And so I set my sights on it at that time. And by, oh goodness, I think I was 23 years old, I started my first animal job out of college. And I'd gone to college specifically for animal care and animal behavior, you know, veterinary sciences, et cetera. And I started then at the San Diego Zoo about 7 years into my career. It was November of 2000. And I started off as a part-time keeper in the children's zoo and rolled into a full-time keeper, then senior keeper position. People would ask me often, you know, well, you landed in the children's zoo for your part-time sort of intro position. Where do you want to be? And, you know, sorry, do you want to work with big cats or gorillas or you know, something like that? And I was happy as could be where I was, because the children's zoo is sort of the epicenter of where that first initial contact comes for people to fall in love and get inspired to care about wildlife. And we have, gosh, probably at the time, about 60 different species of birds, mammals, and reptiles there in the children's zoo. Many of them were animals we used for educational programs, so we were able to take them out in public. And part of the job requirement being a keeper there was to bring the animals out to interact with the kids and the families and get them excited about wildlife. And I loved that part of it. You couldn't stop me from talking about the animals that I cared for and what was going on with them in the wild to get others excited about conservation. And because those animals were so good about doing that with us, we also got to work with our public relations department quite a bit. So I was going in studios locally here in San Diego quite often for television segments or radio segments, or hosting media on grounds and getting, accustomed to just working in that environment. And then in 2009, I was able to put in for a position that was temporary, and I would go back to being a keeper afterwards. And that was to represent the organization for the launch of Elephant Odyssey. This was back in 2009. And at the time, that was the largest and most expensive space we had ever opened up at the San Diego Zoo for our elephants and many other species. So I stepped away from my keeper role and was a spokesperson then for about, I think it was 8 or 9 months, went back to being a keeper. And then they asked me to do sort of the ambassador role again for the relaunch of our polar bear plunge in 2010. And in the middle of doing all that, they said, hey, would you like to stay on permanently as a spokesperson for the organization? So I represent the San Diego Zoo and the Safari Park. I work closely with all of our teams. I've been able to travel all over the world doing this. They've sent me to many of our conservation sites in Africa and Australia, Galapagos Islands, et cetera. And then, of course, you know, I have the pleasure of doing things like this, sharing my passion and excitement for what we do for wildlife around the world. You know, for interviews like this, I've been to New York and Los Angeles doing all the talk shows and things like that. And it's just been an amazing journey that I honestly, just following my passion, just following my love for animals and wanting to share that love with everybody else has placed me in this unique position.
Wow, what an awesome story. I didn't even know all that about you. And I think that is so, so awesome that you just had this passion for animals. And now here you are getting to do what you do.
Essentially it was like, hey, he won't shut up. So let's put him in front of the camera.
Yeah, right. Well, you're great at it. Maybe you'd actually come into our studio up in Carlsbad and bring some animals with you.
Yeah, when we get a little further, I think through the woods of the pandemic stuff, you know, there's still a lot of questions about what will or will not affect our animals, and the ability to keep them safe is our top priority. So, but yes, I'm hopeful someday we'll be able to bring animals back in studios and have some fun adventures with that.
Well, now that you bring that up, let's segue into that. So last March, you know, everything's going along as usual. And then the pandemic hits and everything shuts down. So the zoo is affected on two levels, right? Because your revenue, I think you guys only made about half your annual revenue that you normally make in 2020. So you were affected in that way, but you still constantly had to upkeep the animals and keep them safe and healthy. So you had both, right? You had the money aspect of it, and then also you have to care for these animals. So what was that like for you all there?
Challenging, to say the least. Yeah. And I recognize too, and so does our organization, we aren't alone in the many challenges that came up during the pandemic for businesses and people in general. I mean, just what a thing for all of us to go through. As far as our organization, yes, it was March 13th. We were told that we will be staying open through the weekend and then be closing basically the end of Sunday. And that was our first closure in the history of the organization. We've had only twice that we've closed in the history of the organization as far as in our non-operational hours. And all of us, we were kind of like, okay, well, they say it's about 2 weeks. Well, maybe a couple more weeks.
I remember the two week thing with my kids at school.
Yeah, and it just kind of kept rolling. right. So for our organization, yes, a lot of our workers are essential workers, that our animals needed their top-notch care. So we're talking about our nutritionists, our vet staff, our wildlife care specialists or keepers, all of those, anybody who has anything to do with the care of these animals had to report to work. But we had to keep people safe and keep our animals safe. So a lot of teams were split in half. And their work schedule was shifted so those two half teams, A team and B team, would never cross paths. So if someone should become ill, then that team that needs to be, you know, sort of set aside to make sure no one else is ill, the other team could come in and cover still everything needed to be covered. And so there was a lot of logistics on that side of it. And then our plants too. We're a registered botanical garden with many endangered species of plants. So our botanical team, our horticulturist, still had to come in and maintain everything and keep everything going. So we had a large amount of staff that was still working full time in these, you know, unusual times at that. And then, like you mentioned, there was no revenue coming in. And our revenue, of course, is a big part of how, as a nonprofit organization, not only do we care for our staff and our animals, but then also get to do the conservation work we do. And I have to tell you, I think it was probably about 3 weeks into it, once we all kind of realized that the two-week thing was not really a thing, that we started getting phone calls. You know, the community of San Diego and our membership base recognizes, as a nonprofit organization, and the work that we do is unique, that not having that front gate revenue is going to be an issue. And the San Diego community at large stepped up and started donating money during the pandemic.
Wow, that's so cool. I love to hear that.
It gives me goosebumps now, just because, you know, I've been working there for over 20 years and it's part of my life. You know, it's not just a job. It is a part of my life. It's a lifestyle to be in this kind of work that we do. And to know that we had that kind of support, love, and care from our community to step forward and keep us afloat during the pandemic was just amazing. And we all are still, you know, we still talk about it, just like, how did that happen? But it was really wonderful, and we're very thankful.
Well, I think it's making me think, because, you know, people have such a heartfelt connection to the zoo on many levels. It's like, right. I remember going there as a young child. I remember going there with my Brownie Scout troop group or whatever. And then it was, I remember going there with my kids when they were little. And like you said, introducing them to the animals for the first time. Mm-hmm. So I can see why, you know, it was like people's hearts were just, oh, we have to reach out to the zoo. I think that's an amazing story. Now tell me, I remember hearing, I think it was nationwide news, something about apes getting COVID. Did that happen, and what happened with that?
Yeah, so we have several ape species, both at the zoo and safari park. And if anyone watching is not aware, the safari park is about 30 some miles to the north of the zoo. The zoo is based sort of in downtown San Diego. If you go further to the north, an area called San Pascual Valley, it's a much more sort of agricultural open space, and we have the safari park there. You can fit about 18 San Diego zoos inside the safari park's property line, just to give you an idea. So you can see behind us is kind of what it looks like. It's a very open space. So at both areas, we have apes and primates and other animals. Our gorillas tested positive for COVID during the pandemic, during the shutdown. So we knew that at least one, if not two, but we just treated the whole group as they had COVID. Now, COVID is, although it's a disease that can jump back and forth, a virus that can jump back and forth between humans and animals, the reaction of the body and how it affects the body is different for each species. And there's a lot of unknowns, though. We weren't really sure what to expect. So we immediately, of course, tested all of the staff that works in the area. Someone showed up as positive but asymptomatic, and so we assume that was how the gorillas became exposed. We weren't open to the public at the time.
Okay,
and of course, all of our staff's required to wear masks and gowns and gloves when working with animals because we recognize the challenges that this virus could cause the animals.
We have to go to a quick commercial break, and this is a good cliffhanger because I want to know what happened with this, and I want to hear more about what we're going to do about vaccinating the animals if you are. So stick around, audience at home, and stick around, Rick. We're going to take a quick break and come back with more with Rick Schwartz right after this. You're watching America Friends.
It's all happening at the zoo. I do believe it. I do believe it.
You are watching America Trends, and we are here with Rick Schwartz from the world famous San Diego Zoo. And Rick, gosh, I had to go to a commercial break and I had to interrupt you, but we were just talking about COVID and some of the apes at the zoo or the safari park got COVID. And you were mentioning, I think, something that maybe it wasn't, didn't present itself the same way as it did in humans.
Right. Well, you know, for all of us, there's a lot of unknowns about COVID, especially at that time, as far as how it would impact other species. We know it was zoonotic or zoonotic disease, which means it transfers from human to animal and vice versa. Some facilities, there were some big cats that got it, and there wasn't much more than some coughing and then some downtime as far as being maybe a little tired and then being okay. But for apes, we weren't sure what to expect. So we basically just made sure they, you know, everything was really, really well taken care of for them. We treated it as if the whole group had it. Of course, there's no actual medicine to give necessarily. You can treat symptoms. Thankfully, for the most part, shy of some coughing, there wasn't really a lot presenting itself. They were eating and feeding and, you know, doing everything normally. So we weren't too worried as we got further along. What has made even more news, though, was then there was rumors going around that they were then vaccinated. That group, that troop of gorillas was not vaccinated because they already were exposed to COVID. However, a company did approach us that was testing vaccines for animals only, not human vaccines. And they asked if they could test some of the vaccines with us, you know, in accordance to our veterinary standards with some of our apes. And so some apes at the zoo then, not the Safari Park group, did receive vaccines for this trial through this other organization that was doing just animal-only vaccines, non-human vaccines, basically.
And are they the same companies like Pfizer and Moderna for the animals?
No,
it's
a veterinary science company. The name I can't recall right now in the moment, but no, it's not not the same pharmaceutical organizations.
It's not the same dose that I got in the shot.
Right,
okay.
Right. Yeah.
Okay,
completely different.
And so you will see how those trials go and then make decisions moving forward, if you will do that.
Well, we're working with them, yeah, to share the data and information. And so the goal of any trial on a pharmaceutical item like this would be, we're participating in that trial, but it's up to them to then decide, the organization who's doing the actual pharmaceutical work, to decide if this is something that would then be released out for others to use, whether in the zoo environment or pet world, et cetera.
Now, speaking of vaccinations, it's been a topic of conversation in the news for various concerts, and cruise lines and different theme parks have talked about whether or not they're going to require vaccination cards from guests and attendees. Is that something that the zoo has talked about requiring for their guests, or is that not even on the table?
As far as I know, it's not on the table. We're following all the guidelines that San Diego County Health Department and CDC are requiring of large, you know, group gatherings, you know, places like the zoo or safari park. And we follow those guidelines all the way through. And it's been wonderful. Our guests and members have always complied to whatever's needed to make sure they can come enjoy the zoo safely. And we had a lot of restrictions when we had opened up earlier on. But now, as of June 15th, California has lifted all restrictions. So we're at operations as normal. There is the recommendation that if you're not vaccinated, that you wear a mask. But if you're vaccinated, you're fine not to wear a mask. And there is nobody requesting proof of that at this time.
Okay, great. It's so nice to have everything open. Oh, my gosh. And now I see that you're open. I'm going to have have to bring my kids by.
Absolutely.
Now, tell me what kinds of new things that you guys have working. I mean, I'm sure during the pandemic, you had time to kind of strategize what you're going to bring up. What kind of new habitats or openings do you have coming up?
Well, just a few weeks ago, we opened our brand new Komodo kingdom and our hummingbird habitat. So longtime zoo fans know we've had Komodo dragons before, and it's kind of been an area attached to the reptile house. And then you kind of walk across a little bit of a distance, and you would kind of have to go down this garden trail to this tucked away little hummingbird habitat next door. Over the, well, even prior to COVID, actually, we'd been working on leveling that area out and rebuilding brand new state-of-the-art facilities for our Komodo dragons and our hummingbirds. And that officially opened, like I said, just a few weeks ago to the public. So they're there, open now, and it's gorgeous. We have a male and female Komodo dragon. There's three sort of separate habitat spaces that can be joined or kept separate. Our goal, hopefully in the future, is we'll maybe have the pitter-patter of some little dragon feet. And then you walk across the way like you did before, and this is unbelievable. You're transported immediately to this sort of tropical rainforest with all these different bird species, including hummingbirds, flying around enjoying the space. And I recommend, don't just walk through the hummingbird habitat. Like, you walk to the Komodo dragons, you can see them, they're big. Hummingbirds are so small that if you're just walking through, you could miss them flying and doing their thing, and your eyes can't really see where they are because of the plants and everything until they move. So sit down, relax, enjoy the atmosphere, and all of a sudden you'll start seeing all these birds everywhere, and you can start watching what they're doing, and it's just absolutely beautiful. And then coming up in October, I'm extremely excited, really beyond, I can't even, beyond words, our new children's zoo is going to open. Ooh. So like I mentioned earlier in the interview, I started in the original children's zoo. The original children's zoo opened in the 1950s. I joined the team there in 2000.
Is that at the same location as the...
Yes.
Okay.
It'll be the same footprint, but a completely different experience.
Wow, cool.
They're going full state of the art. There's so much immersion for families where you're going to be, all the senses essentially are going to be, you know, sort of tickled, if you will, for different things. There'll be different smells and sights and sounds. We're going to have a whole new entomology area where you'll be introduced to the world of the insects and bugs, and that's going to then go into mammals and our reptiles and everything else. There's multiple levels now. They dug out a bunch of dirt to create this, you know, water feature that comes through, and it's going to be amazing. There's going to be so much going on. It'll be one of those parts of the zoo where you'll spend more, probably a couple hours there, not expecting it to take that long, but because there's so much to do and see, it's just going to be really exciting. Like I mentioned, the children's is really the space where we first get to excite and entice and spark that desire and interest to learn more about wildlife and animals. And this is going to be just that times a million, and I can't wait for it to open.
Oh, I can't wait. That's so exciting. You know, it is so amazing to go as a parent with a child and see their eyes light up and see just the sparkle in their eyes. It's like the first time you take them to Disneyland or anything, and then to see them at the zoo and then see them. There's some encounters where you can actually get up close to them, right? That's so exciting. I can't wait. So
and I want to add too, as a parent myself, I know sometimes you think, my one-year-old, my two-year-old, I'm not going to go, they wouldn't get anything out of it. Trust me, their little eyes, they may not fully understand they're looking at an orangutan or a Komodo dragon or an elephant, but their eyes will track and they'll follow, and they see those unique and different things and they get excited. It's interesting to them, and it's so fun. You get a membership and you can come back time and time again for that just one annual fee, and your children get to grow up there with that experience.
Pure
and
joy.
You as a parent get to see that too. It's really wonderful.
Rick, thank you so much for being here. I hope you'll come in studio when it's safe for everyone and bring maybe one of these little animals that we can have in studio. What a wonderful show tonight. I loved it, every second of it, with Mariana Cimino and Rick Schwartz. You can watch America Trends every night of the week, Monday through Friday at 10 p.m. Eastern. Good night. I'm Mary Burt-Godwin.